2, and I shall read verses 15 through 17. This is what the Apostle John says. Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For everything in the world, like the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, are not from the Father, but from the world. The world and its desires pass away, but the one who does the will of God lives forever. Amen. The most difficult challenge that Christians face today is how to live in the world without allowing the world to live in us. Living in union with Christ and at the same time avoiding the pressures of life is by no means an easy task. This world has its own values, traditions, and customs. This world has its idea of success and its beguiling temptations. Geraldine Farrar, the former prima donna of the Metropolitan Opera, once said, "So much is pressing in on humans today that they don't have time to stand still to evaluate life. So they swallow life hastily and taste nothing." Our purpose this morning is to stand still long enough to evaluate our relationship with Jesus Christ and also our relationship to this world. In the Gospel of John, chapter 17, verse 5, Jesus says, "We are to be in the world, but we are not to be of the world." We don't have to live in isolation like hermits or monks who spend their lives in monasteries. We have to be in the world, we have to be in touch with the world and its people, but at the same time we should not allow this world to capture our soul. While living as God's people in this world, we should not allow ourselves to be ensnared by the customs, traditions, philosophies of this world. In reality, we live in two worlds. There is the inner world of our relationship with Christ, and then there's the outer world. We should allow the inner world to direct all our activities in the outer world, and we should not permit the outer world to invade our thinking, to dominate our life, to set our agenda, or to dictate to us how we should live. In short, what the Apostle John says to us in today's scripture reading is that we have to love God more than we love the world. In the New Testament, the term world has profound moral implications. To be in the world, to live in the world, is to live a life that is apart from God. To live in the world is to live independently from God. The world is any person, any relationship, any structure of society, any situation that has not been redeemed by God's grace. The world is this creation that is rising in rebellion against its creator. The world is fallen and sinful humanity that has forsaken God, its purpose, His purpose and His plan. The world is any government that rules without justice and without righteousness. The world is any economic system that doesn't care for people, but strives to exploit people for the benefit of the ruling class. So you can see the term world in the New Testament has many profound implications. The world attracts and entices people by promising to offer them fame, popularity, power, prestige, influence, wealth, and prosperity. According to Jesus, we can gain the world and lose our soul. And Jesus says, what shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? If we lose the salvation of our souls, we've lost everything. Because there's nothing, Jesus says, that we can give in exchange for our lost soul. In Hebrews chapter 11, verses 24-26, reference is made to the experience of the prophet Moses. They were told that Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter, but chose to suffer with the people of God in the wilderness, rather than enjoying the pleasures of sin for a short time. The way Moses had a choice, we too have a choice. We can choose to live in sin and enjoy its pleasures, which the Bible says don't last very long. Or we can choose to comply with God's instructions, submit ourselves to Him to guide us, and try to do His will. The Apostle John gives us the secret of how to live the Christian life. And the first advice he gives us says, don't love the world. Don't love this world and the things that are in the world. When Jesus was here on this earth, he rejected this world's value system. He refused to adopt this world's distorted religious system. And he did not accept the materialism of his day. Jesus resisted the efforts of both his disciples and of the religious leaders of his day to misdirect his mission and to water down his teachings. Jesus came to this world primarily to seek and to save the lost and to reconcile sinners to God from whom they've been alienated. Because we love God supremely, we care for people and oppose the world's value system that tends to dehumanize people and rob them of their personal dignity. Thomas Carlyle, the famous Scottish philosopher, essayist, teacher, who lived in the 18th century, says, the primary purpose of life is to know and love God and serve our fellow man. I agree with him wholeheartedly.
Amen.
The Greek word for church is ekklesia, which literally means those who are called out of the world. Those called out of the world are the community of believers in Jesus Christ. So they constitute the church. The church is not four walls and a roof, The church is a living organism. The church is made up of believers, like you and me. So we are called out from the world. Jesus calls us out. Jesus calls us to come out from this world, and then he equips and empowers us with the gifts of the Holy Spirit and sends us back to the world to be his ambassadors and representatives. Yeah, we're called to serve our fellow men with compassion in order not to be trapped and ensnared by the allurements of the sinful world. The Apostle John tells us that we have to avoid three things. First, he says, avoid the lust of the flesh. The lust of the flesh symbolizes a life that is dominated by carnal desires without any respect for ourselves or the people around us. When the seeking of pleasure is triggered by selfishness, we start using people as toys and then discard them when they no longer are appealing or attractive to us. The second thing the Apostle John tells us to avoid is the lust of the eyes. The lust of the eyes is the desire to possess every new thing that we see, even if we cannot afford it or even when we know it's not useful for us. And the third thing the Apostle John tells us to avoid is the pride of life. It's interesting that the Greek word for pride is alazonia, which means a booster. Pride acts like a narcotic, like a mood changer that gives us a false self-image. In order to feed our ego and stabilize our ego, we always try to acquire status-promoting symbols that in reality are useless. They're useless, have no benefit for us, but we want to acquire them. Why? Because they promote our status. The point that the Apostle John makes is that we try to fill our life with things and activities that replace or displace Jesus Christ. There is an emptiness in our life, and this emptiness can be filled only by God Himself. So don't try to fill the emptiness in your life with things, material things, that have no eternal value. Finally, that is John tells us, this world and its lusts and passions will pass away. This world is, and everything in it, are transitory. They're not permanent. But then he adds, he who does the will of God shall live forever. Amen. So if you're seeking eternal life, your primary concern should be to do God's will, to live a life that is in harmony with God's will. The Scottish poet Robert Burns understood how transitory the pleasures of life are and how they are of a short duration. He likens the pleasures of life to two things. First, he likens the pleasures of this life to red poppies that appear in the fields during springtime. And he says, when you seize the flower, its petals shed immediately. Then he says, or he likens the pleasures of this world to snowflakes that fall into a river. they can retain their form and shape only for a short time, and then they melt away. History has shown us that everything that is worldly does not last forever. My dear brothers and sisters, how we live today in this world will determine where we will spend eternity. If we choose to submit ourselves to Christ and let Him guide us, our pride will be replaced with contentment and joy. So this is the choice that we have to make, and I hope that, like the prophet Moses, we'll choose the right thing. We'll choose to do God's will instead of being entangled by the allurements and sinful pleasures of this world. Christianity is not against us having pleasure. The word joy appears so many times in the epistle to the Philippians. We're told God wants us to rejoice. But to be entangled in the sinful element does not bring joy, it brings disaster. I've seen so many wrecked lives because they chose to adopt the philosophy of this world. So, my dear friends, let us be wise and choose to live for Christ. This is the only way to experience real joy, to have real security, and to inherit eternal life.